Hi, I'm Martha Brockenbrough. I teach at Vermont College of Fine Arts in the MFA program. I'm also the author of novels such as The Game of Love and Death and nonfiction such as Alexander Hamilton, Revolutionary. I'm going to be talking with you today about creative constraints, and I'm going to show you how you can use them to be more innovative as a writer and also fill your writing with tension. All right. When I was a little kid, I liked making potions. It didn't matter what went into them. Shampoo, paprika, dirt. I was a magician at work. As you might guess, I never successfully made a potion. I did, however, make a mess. As I got older, cooking became interesting to me. I started with cakes and then moved on to pasta. And by the time I was 12, I could make cannelloni completely from scratch. How? By following a recipe. That's the difference between a mess and magic. I still cook, and I've been doing it long enough that for a lot of things, I don't even need a recipe anymore. That doesn't mean that I'm dumping any old thing into a pot. It means I understand the chemistry of the process enough that I know what goes in, how much belongs, and most important, what doesn't. That last part, writers, is vital. One of the hardest parts of writing a book is knowing what not to include. So today, I'm going to talk about creative constraints and how you can use these to set limits for yourself as a vital part of your creative process. Creative constraints aren't new. So Homer's Odyssey is good and ancient. The written version is in dactylic hexameter, which is a very specific rhythm. It means that there's six da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da beats in a line. Likewise, Shakespeare's plays are in iambic pentameter. And then there are his sonnets, which follow a form of all their own. The constraints are part of the work. And I would argue that they were the key to making them good enough to endure. Whether you have a short piece of work, like a sonnet, or even shorter, a limerick, the constraints are set out for you. These forms have specific rules. This isn't the case for novels, especially literary ones. Now, genre novels do have certain expectations. In romance, for example, we have a pair who meet, they experience sparks of some sort, they come together, they're separated, and then finally they get a happily ever after. So one of the genius parts about genre novel is the way that skilled writers find engaging and surprising ways to leverage these reader expectations. This gives readers a double dose of pleasure. First, there's the anticipation of these moments, and then the surprise when the expectation is met in an unexpected way. So if you're writing a genre novel, know what you're about. Meet those expectations, which are the creative constraints, and then find some clever way to exceed them. Okay, but what if you're writing a literary novel? Or what if you're doing a fantasy that has some significant world building? Well, the challenge here is to know what constraints that you need to come up with. These become the foundation, the walls, and the roof of your house. They're what is going to give your work shape, what will help readers engage in it. And that is a fancy way of saying what will help you help your readers develop expectations that you will then deliver on in surprising yet inevitable ways. So genre does that for you because that's the nature of the genre. But if you're writing literary fiction, that's work that you have to do yourself. For each book that you write, you're likely to have to come up with a different set of creative constraints. For example, a picture book of mine that came out this fall is called This Old Dog. It's told from the point of view of a dog. All right. So picture books, if you're not familiar with them, already have a major constraint. They're just a few hundred words long. In that space, you have to establish a character and put them through a plot arc that somehow resolves. I added a key constraint, though, in addition to the length one. Because this book is told from the point of view of a dog, every word in it is one syllable. Why did I do that? Well, it made sense here because the language that dogs understand best tends to be monosyllabic words. Think about it. Sit, down, stay, ball, treat, walk. Who's a good dog? All single syllable words. So it made sense for me to do this when I'm writing a book about a dog. This is an example of a creative constraint that both reveals and builds character. It also forced me to be more creative in my language, which is the third thing that it can do. So when you're thinking about the character of your book, ask yourself, what language does my character use? Jane Austen does this in a really cool way in Pride and Prejudice. The novel is told in a third-person point of view. In the entire first chapter, we don't even meet our heroine directly, but we're already immersed in her point of view because of Austen's word choice. Specifically, in the percentage of Latinate versus Anglo-Saxon words that she chooses. Even if you don't know what that means, you know the difference already. Latinate words tend to be snooty, fancy ones, like Latinate, or like conflagration. Anglo-Saxon words tend to be shorter, earthier, like fire instead of conflagration. The percentage of Latinate words in the narration of Pride and Prejudice matches the heroine's dialogue. Meanwhile, the pompous characters in the novel, Mr. Darcy and the oily minister, Mr. Collins, use a higher percentage of snooty Latinate words. The dummies in the novel, her little sisters Kitty and Lydia, use no Latinate words at all. So in aligning the percentage of Latinate words to Elizabeth Bennet, the main character, the narration and the protagonist are tied together. It makes her more sympathetic. There is some interesting variation though. When Elizabeth Bennet gets more emotional, her speech gets more Anglo-Saxon. So how are you supposed to use that? Well, think about the language your character uses. How is it different from other characters in the book? How is the voice of the narrator the same or different from your protagonist? How do your character's word choices change in times of great emotion? What about things like the length of the sentences? How do those change? One concrete thing you can do is take all of the dialogue out of your novel and put it into a spreadsheet with separate columns for each character. Then you read the dialogue and ask yourself, does everyone sound distinct? Do each of the characters sound consistent within their column? Do you have a character with verbal tics that you can repeat to create running gags or on the opposite end, running sources of irritation? All right, so along with what our characters say and how they say it is another thing. It's what they don't say. Sometimes characters don't say or note something in the text because it's such familiar content that they don't need to note it or observe it. For example, you would be very unlikely to write, "Mary walked through the rectangular door," because that is almost always an unnecessary bit of information in our world. If all of the doors in your world are rectangular, you don't need to say it at all. That's why it always rings a bit hollow when writers include information strictly for the benefit of the reader. She looked at her 12-year-old brother, Andy, and sighed. That sentence is a clunker, isn't it? Here's something that might be better. She looked at her brother and said, "I can see the first of your mustache hairs. Sorry about the puberty, kid." The reader can figure out about how old the brother is and also gets a glimpse of the relationship between the two kids. So to summarize again, you don't want your character to say something that's unnecessary or to say something that they know intimately that they would have no reason to say at that moment. You have to find a more creative way of showing your character what the world looks like, how old the characters are, etc. All right. So Ernest Hemingway has a short story called Hills Like White Elephants. In it, a couple is sitting at a bar and they're looking at a view and they're ordering drinks. There's a lot of tension between them, little arguments that go back and forth. They're kind of petty. Then suddenly the man changes the topic. I'm going to read to you a little bit from the scene. The warm wind blew the bead curtain against the table. The beer's nice and cold, the man said. It's lovely, the girl said. It's really an awfully simple operation, Jig, the man said. It's not really an operation at all. The girl looked at the ground the table legs rested on. I know you wouldn't mind it, Jig. It's really not anything. It's just to let the air in. The girl did not say anything. I'll go with you and I'll stay with you all the time. They just let the air in and then it's all perfectly natural. Now, there's something these characters aren't talking about. It gets to be where Jig doesn't even reply to him at all. She's looking at the table leg. I should say that the first time I read this story, I had just read Ken Kesey's One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. In case you haven't read that one, here's a spoiler alert. It ends with a lobotomy. So as a 15-year-old reader fresh off of that book, quote, they just let the air in and then it's all perfectly natural, seemed like a lobotomy to me. Really though, the characters are talking about a potential abortion. The word abortion isn't mentioned one time in this story. The characters don't need to say that word. They know what they're talking about. The fact that it's unnamed and unmentionable gives this story a whole lot more tension, interest, and intrigue. I'd argue it's that restraint that most firmly cements this story in the literary category. This leaves room for the reader to think. It's the most dramatic thing in the whole story, and it's never once mentioned. So as long as the reader hasn't had a lobotomy or isn't a 15-year-old who's fresh off of Ken Kesey, they're going to figure it out. As a writer, you can trust your reader with that sort of information. What that does, it creates space for the reader. And once that reader is in that space, they're hooked in your story. So as you think about this for your own work, ask yourself, what is the thing that's related to your character's desire that they cannot talk about? What can they not say to other significant characters in their life? What is so intimately known that they don't need to say it? As you get to know your characters, make lists of all of this stuff. Have a notebook where you write it all down, where there are things that remain unsaid that have stakes to them, like confessions of love or guilt or what have you. The expression of those unsaid things is going to be intimately connected with the climax of your novel. This is where the dam breaks. And if you don't build the dam in the first place, a structure made of things unsaid, then that break won't be as dramatic as it can be. All of this stuff needs to be on the page, not necessarily literally, but in its palpable absence. That negative space is what leaves room for the reader. It pulls the reader in. And that is one of the things that keeps people turning pages. So with my students at Vermont College, I have a fun writing prompt that I'm going to encourage you to play with. Pretend you have a character who's on their way to boarding school. It's not just any boarding school. It's one for sad clowns or for extremely nearsighted witches. I want you to write the scene where they walk into their dorm room for the first time with all of their stuff. And that's where they meet their roommate or somebody else. There's just one rule to this prompt. You cannot say what kind of school it is. You cannot use the word sad clowns or extremely nearsighted witches, or whatever school you've chosen. Then read your scene to someone and see if they can figure out what type of school this is. This writing prompt is meant to force you to be creative. It forces you to show something vital, and that is a way of making your writing better. All right, speaking of extremely nearsighted witches, world building is an essential part of every story. With contemporary books, usually the world building is less apparent. That doesn't mean it isn't there. Here, realism becomes a constraint. You obviously want your characters to seem like real people. Constraints are how you do this. So what parts of your book do you need to research? Are there medical scenes, legal scenes, anything sciency, to use a very technical term? Do you use particular locations? Then you need maps. All of this stuff, when I say that reality is a constraint, you have to know intimately the lives of your characters. And if you're portraying real world stuff on the page, then you have to know how it works in the real world, or your book will fall apart in the eyes and hands of someone who does have that knowledge. Okay, let's say your book is historical. You also need all sorts of information right down to the language that your characters use. Now, there's certain library resources that help a whole lot here. The Oxford English Dictionary, which is available through Seattle Public Library's website, will tell you if a certain word was in use during the era you're writing about. For example, my novel, The Game of Love and Death, is set in 1937 Seattle. I needed to know what they called those kind of tan pants that I saw boys wearing in pictures. Were those khakis? Were they chinos? I found they were definitely not chinos, because that word wasn't used in that context until 1943. Another funny thing about pants in that book, I thought that my character could be looking at his fly to see if it was unzipped, but I had to first research whether zippers were invented in 1937, and I found that they were Vogue magazine's fashion innovation of the year in 1937. And I thought at first that I could use that scene where he's examining his zipper. No, I couldn't, a more skilled researcher told me, because in 1937 in Seattle, it was very unlikely that the fashion innovation of the year had made it all the way to the pair of a boy's pants. So you really do need to be careful with your research, because someone is going to know. When you veer into fantasy, there are additional rules to create. A failure here isn't necessarily the end of the world. I mean, I guess giant eagles could have flown into Mordor at any point and dropped the ring and spared us that whole story. He got away with it. Very often, though, you are going to need the rules for your story to work. So I wanted to write a novel in which a sentient forest turns carnivorous. I use nonfiction resources, believe it or not. Peter Wohlleben's book, The Hidden Life of Trees, and Oliver Sacks' book, River of Consciousness, showed me evidence and mechanisms of awareness and cooperative behavior in trees that I didn't know before I read it, and then I was able to lean into in my book. It meant less stuff that I needed to make up. I also wanted the forest to give off a scary sounding music. Here, I turned to the art of a German composer named Bartholomaus Traubeck. He took slices of trees and he used their rings to make them into something that could be played like a record. I highly recommend you look it up. The music is awesome. You spell his last name T as in Tom, R-A-U-B-E-C-K, and Bartholomaus is his first name. Okay. So the music he made was absolutely perfect. It was exactly what I imagined, but didn't quite have the words for. Once I listened to it over and over again, though, I could use it for my descriptions of the music that the forest was playing. I'm a musician myself, so I'm familiar with music, but it's a forest, so I couldn't use any instruments. My rules prevented that. They're trees. They don't have cellos or trumpets or pianos. So I had to describe sounds in absence of all those reference points. And so this bit of research that I did helped me do that. But then I had to ask myself, okay, fine. You've got a musical forest. What made the forest start to make music? Why? Why did it do this? Even though that was my original idea all along, coming up with an answer for it gave me a plot element. Another plot element showed the forest shifts from simply being musical to also eating flesh. So if you're making stuff up for the world in the book, here are my two best recommendations. One, do that real world research. You might end up needing to make up less stuff than you thought. Second is, when you have purely fantastical elements like trees eating people, think about why you want to do this. What is your subconscious trying to tell you? Come up with an answer for it. You don't necessarily need to include the answer in your story at all. Maybe it's just a thing in that world, and that is part of the physics of that world. Then again, it might help you shape your plot. And that is ultimately what creative constraints are meant for us to do. They help us force ourselves to find creative solutions that we otherwise might not have considered, might not even have thought of. The blank page can be a scary thing to look at, terrifying. But once you've put some lines on it and then color inside of them, you'll be surprised at what you manage to think of. Chances are, it'll be a whole lot more surprising and delightful than anything you could have thought of without those lines. Just like pies made from a good recipe are far tastier than pies made with mud. Thanks for watching. Good luck, everyone.